Radio in TV.
Radio in TV.
Three, two, one.
And here we are, back with my girls.
Well, maybe that is, I just remember that.
Yeah, the one of those two.
Radio in TV.
Radio in TV.
I couldn't give you a child. And suddenly, I wasn't enough for you anymore.
That's not true. You're my wife.
Let me go.
Okay?
Let me go.
You're my wife.
No.
Now look at this. This is your ring, all right? Your wedding ring. Put it on.
No. No!
Crystal,
I won't
do it. We said vows right here in this very room, okay?
Are you
out of your mind? You're my wife, dear. Now put the freaking ring on. Put it on.
Oh my God.
I watched that and I was
crying.
Oh my God.
I watched that and I was like, oh my God, that is so real. Yeah.
It was that was
so
really,
really
good. Intense scene. And
because you know what? That's how married people fight. That's how married people fight.
True.
It's intense.
Absolutely. And it was interesting. We shot that scene one day and the director of the day, his name is Stephen Williford, who's also on Days of Our Lives right now, from what I understand. He came running out of the booth afterwards, and this is exactly what he came running and goes, I love my fucking job! Oh my gosh, I love it! It was like, he was so like enthusiastic, he was so excited, it was that kind of a moment.
That
it
was just, so
and I'm
good.
Saying verbatim, that's how he said it.
That
it was just,
is
it was
so
fun.
Funny.
That
well,
was so
yeah.
good.
You won an Emmy for that role, for Best Supporting
yes,
Actor
right.
as David Hayward, and
yeah.
from that scene alone, very well deserved.
I mean, we know what that's like. Anyone who's married has passion in their marriage.
Well,
he was
determined
like.
To make sure that she wore the ring, apparently. It was
yes.
like, yes, you're my wife, you will wear this ring.
Yeah, but,
no.
but it's not about the ring.
It's not
about
the absolutely.
It's
not
about
the ring.
The ring.
So that was with Bobby Eakes, who is also one of our very favorite people here at SoapBox. And
has she done the show?
She hasn't, but she's going to.
She's going.
Okay, good.
We had a nice conversation about that recently. So after you did All My Children in New York, you went on to do the Prospect Park version as well, right?
That's right, in Connecticut.
And
yes.
how was that different for you? Because we've talked to a few people about this.
Yeah.
Well, it was different in that it wasn't the consistency of working week in, week out.
Mm-hmm.
It was on a schedule of a few weeks on, a few weeks off,
right.
a few weeks on. And then we were flying back and forth to Connecticut, working there. It was a great team that was in Connecticut. You know, it was disheartening the way that it dissolved, how
mm-hmm.
it ended.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of things going on there, some litigation on all sides, and even arbitration with the unions,
mm-hmm.
the whole thing. So I personally decided that I would rather focus on the positives of it, because there were definitely negatives. I could say there were certain things that, from all appearances, seemed to have been mishandled.
Mm-hmm.
But until those things are resolved, I really don't want to talk too much about that. But there was a lot of things that they did right as
mm-hmm.
well. And I would
mm-hmm.
say that the production values were wonderful.
Yeah.
And I think that their hearts were truly in the right place.
Yeah.
They had the best intentions to do this. The writing was great. The quality.
It really
was.
It looked fantastic.
It looked fantastic.
And they did it for a fraction of the budget.
That's right.
Which I thought was really
We killed
phenomenal.
Ourselves for 5 weeks to put it together when we were doing it. But we were all very, very, very proud of the end.
Now, let me ask you this. What are your personal thoughts on this whole genre that has surfaced on the web, soaps going to the web? Do you think that that's really the future of soaps? Or what are your thoughts on that?
Well, I think that it certainly has opened up a lot of opportunities, in not only for soaps, for daytime, but for other programming as well.
Mm.
And it's happening all over the place.
Right.
I mean, I was just at the YouTube space a few weeks ago here in L.A., and it's extraordinary what they're providing people that have a certain amount of subscribers that they get there. There's so much original content being done online. And, you know, this is happening in tandem with what's happening in nighttime television as well. I really do feel that right now we're going through a renaissance in nighttime television with the extraordinary programming that's on there.
Incredible.
It's been
incredible.
Some of the best dramatic television. I rarely go to the movies anymore. I don't see any films.
You don't need
films.
To.
You don't need to, because we could sit there and watch, binge watch shows, and they're like amazing.
What are some of your favorite shows?
Well, Breaking Bad is certainly one of them. I just finished watching it with my girlfriend for the second time. She didn't see it the first time around, and she just kept hearing about it. And we went to several Breaking Bad events with the cast and with the producers, and she's like, I have to watch it. Right. So we watch, and she was totally blown away by it, and rightfully so. It is probably one of the most well-written shows out there. It's so tight.
And Aaron Paul is just a flippin' miracle.
He's fantastic, so good. Straight through the entire series. Yeah. And he also is a wonderful man. I've met him on several occasions, and he's just so genuine and really gracious.
Oh, and he has a great story of how he made it as well.
He did such an incredible job with that role and just got better and better right up until the end.
And you were on one of the best shows on television, I think, Homeland. Last year.
Yeah.
And when you were on, I was like, oh my God, I know him.
Yeah. it was fun. It was
Claire
great.
Danes, tell me what she's like, please.
Well, it was so fast, you know. I honestly, it was an interesting thing. This is one of those moments where I'm so grateful because of networking. It wasn't intended to be a networking opportunity, but I was at an event at the Television Academy, of which I'm a member, and it was for Shameless, actually. It was Showtime, Showtime show, and an executive from there, from Showtime, came up to me, a woman who recognized me, knew my work, and she was a fan of mine, and we had a really nice conversation. And she asked me, what shows did I love from Showtime? And I said, I love Homeland. I watch it all the time. It's
one
an amazing
of my favorites.
Show. Well, she apparently told the casting director in New York that if anything came up, consider him for it. It was a month later.
Wow.
My agent calls me and says, they want you to put yourself on tape for this role they're casting out of New York. I was like, great. Put myself on tape, send it to her. It was like 2 days later, I'm getting a call. They're putting on a plane tomorrow to fly there. It was so fast. I literally left like on a Wednesday, shot it Friday morning, and then was back on, oh no, on Wednesday, shot on Thursday morning and flew back on Friday. So it was quick.
Are you here in LA now, permanently?
I'm in Los Angeles, yeah.
Okay, because isn't it true that when you were working in New York, you were living in LA, and when you were working in LA, you were living in New York?
Yes.
And like, you really are one of the most
insane.
Well-traveled actors
oh
in daytime.
You know, when I was doing Young and the Restless, that was supposed to be a 3-month job,
and
it turned into 2 years.
Right.
Which is a blessing, obviously. But I was flying back like every week, every week and a half, to be with my kids for 3 days, 4 days, and fly back to LA for 4 days, and back there for 5, and back here for 6. I was doing that constantly for 2 years. And when that show ended, it was great. I got a call 2 days after Young and the Restless ended from all my children asking me to come back. So I was like, great, I'm going to be back in New York on the East Coast. I'll be there with my kids and be able to be there. And it happened for 10 months, and then they called us into the stage where the View was with ABC and all the executives, and they told us that we were moving the show to Los Angeles. I'm going, are you kidding me? I'm doing this again on a show that's been planted here for 40 years.
Yeah.
We're moving it to LA.
Wow.
So that's
so you don't like to travel then?
No.
No, no part of it?
I know how to travel. I read good books. I watch great shows on my computer and, you know, or my iPad now, you know, so
my husband
that's
and
what I do.
We have a little game because we used to travel all the time because we have a restaurant in San Francisco. Mm-hmm. We would each get in different lines at the security so you could get through fastest. You know, it's about like taking off your belt first, then your shoes, that you know, like getting everything just aligned as properly.
Well, you know, it's funny actually when I was doing on The Restless, Thaddeus Luckinbill and Amelia, they both kept telling me how great Lost was. They said, oh, you have to get Lost, you have to watch it. It was still on at the time. So I decided I bought the DVD set for the first season, and I put it on the airplane, and I'm watching now. If you remember, the first episode is a plane crash.
Oh, gosh.
And I'm sitting there on the plane watching this, and then the plane crash is happening. The plane's ripping apart. People are flying out, and it's like I'm, like, taking my screen, and I'm lowering it like this, and I'm looking around. And I'm going, there's some things you don't want to watch on an airplane, you know?
Wow. Now, this is your 30th year, right, in soaps?
That's right. Yeah, it started in 1983, on Guiding Light.
And you worked with Judy Evans. You guys were like one of the biggest super couples in daytime.
Yeah, it was Beth and Lou Jack,
Wow. And I read somewhere that you were actually a waiter when you got that job.
Yeah.
And that job was actually only supposed to be for a few days.
Yeah, it's interesting because that's happened to me several times with soaps.
You just said Y&R.
Happened with Y&R. Actually, I even happened with all my children.
Really?
It was a 3-month gig.
Are you serious?
It's a testament to your talent.
Wow.
Well, I'm grateful. I mean, and the character had so much potential, you know. But with Guiding Light, it was a 3-day gig, and it was an extraordinary transition in my life. You know, I had been doing theater in New York for six wow. years, New York and Boston. I hadn't done anything on TV yet. And I went and read for an amazing casting director who's no longer with us, Betty Ray. And I had such a good time auditioning with her because I improvised in the scene with her. And it was supposed to be the scene where I walk in into a girl's room to follow this. Krista Tessera was playing Mindy at the time, and walk in there with her. And I'm just hanging out with her, shooting it with her. And she's like, what are you doing here? But I was flirting with her, right? So I do that with Betty Ray, and I like sit down on her desk, and I take out a cigarette, I offer a cigarette, and we start like improvising. She's doing this with me. And she's like, just hold on for a minute. She goes outside to get Gail Colby, who was executive producer at the time. So I watched him, we did this again. And the funny thing was, Hope Smith, who's a producer on a lot of the shows mm-hmm. right now, she was working as a production assistant in the production office right next to Betty Ray's room. And before the scene, I walked out into the room, and I was standing outside the door waiting to go in and prepare myself, and all the production assistants are watching me, and then I'm going, I'll be done in a second, I'm just going in a minute. And we go, she says she'll never forget that, and I go in and I do the scene with her. And so I left there, I went to Joe Allen's, I had just started working there as a waiter. It was my first day having my own shift. And before the shift started, I get a phone call at the bar. They call me over and they say, somebody's on this, my agent. They said, you got the part. I said, fantastic. Everybody's like, are you going to stay? Are you going to leave? I said, no, it's only 3 days. Yeah, of course I'm staying. You
of
know?
Course.
So I got 3 more days out of it. Then they gave me a contract and the character just took
off.
Wow.
That's
so
amazing. So this was a 3-day gig that went right. to a full, I don't know, many, many years. And then you also played the twin. So it actually
right.
turned
Evil
into
twin.
Two roles.
That's right.
Two contract roles and an Emmy nomination.
Nick McHenry.
So after playing yeah. the good guy right. and the bad guy, which yeah. one do you prefer?
Oh, always the bad guy.
Always the bad guy.
They're much, but they're more complex. They're fun. You know, especially if you can identify and sympathize with the characters.
You well,
know?
You
and
have to.
Yeah, I mean, certainly Dr. David was an interesting character. I mean, he was a doctor, a world-renowned cardiologist with a God complex. And, but I always believe, I believe the line between good and evil runs through the heart of every human being. And
right.
some
mm-hmm.
have more or less, to greater or lesser degree.
Yeah, which animal you choose
that's
to feed
right.
more.
That's right. So yeah. I enjoyed doing that. Somebody's singing?
Oh, we okay. just wanted to see you dance before yeah. we had a break.
Do you sing?
Do I sing?
He yeah. sings yeah. so well.
Really?
Yes, and we'll actually get into Ooh. That when we come back from this break. Don't go away. We'll be back also with Holland Reid from HLN's Now. He'll be joining us for In the Suds. Come back on TRadioV. The truth is that my flow retarded, HBD departed. Swagger, I'm stupid, I can't shop in no department and get my money on time. If they got money, decline. I swear I'm in there, there's so much that I get that line of rewind. To get my money on time, if they got money, decline. I just can't worry about no haters, gotta stay on my grind. Now tell me who that, they do that
Radio V. Radio in TV.
Radio in TV.
I feel so blessed, so grateful to have had the opportunity, and I thank God to work on shows for over 25 years, 4 different shows in this medium right now, with some of the hardest working, most talented people this industry has to offer. And I'm not just talking about the people in front of the cameras, the people behind the cameras, the crews, every department, the production staff on these shows. They're the heart of this medium, and my heart goes out to them, and thanks. I thank Chuck Pratt for writing the hell out of this character. He left a message on my voicemail, asked me to come on, saying, come on to the show, let me help you win an Emmy, man.
I love that.
Oh, I love
that. So that was
that.
You winning your Emmy in 2009 yeah. for Best Supporting Actor for David Hayward
right.
on All My Children. So what you said that you're a member of the Academy.
Right, Television Academy here.
And so the Emmys don't have a home this year, a broadcast home. What do you think about that?
You know, first of all, there are 2 different branches of the Academy. The mm-hmm. Academy of Television Arts and Sciences mm-hmm. here mm-hmm. in Los Angeles. And then there's the national one in New York. And
right,
that's
right.
the one that handles the daytime Emmys.
Okay.
The one here is okay. for nighttime.
Okay.
So I don't know what's going on with that. It's tough. But at the same time, the shows have been winnowed down to 4 different shows.
Right.
So I'm not sure how to feel about it right now. I don't know, even with the nominations coming out, there's so few people in the pool now to decide for.
Right.
And I don't know if that changes whether somebody winning or not. I don't know. I'm not sure.
What would you think as a member of the Primetime Academy or whatever that's called? How would you feel about just combining the two? I mean, why do daytime actors have to be separated from the rest of their playgroup?
I don't know. I'm not sure. I don't know what the politics are behind all of that. And maybe someday that will happen.
I feel like that should be...
There's some of the hardest working actors in the industry. I mean, the amount of dialogue that you have to memorize, the amount of emotions you need to bring up in a moment's notice.
That clip we played earlier in the show, I mean, how many people do you know that could do that in one take?
Exactly.
So I feel like that should be our pitch to the Primetime Emmys to include.
And not just the material that you have to sell. You get these crazy storylines, and as an actor, you have to find your truth, and you have to go there and sell it.
Totally.
That's true.
It's the most challenging job for an actor.
But, you know, the interesting thing is I think we've all experienced this, that truth is oftentimes more crazy than fiction.
And, exactly.
That's
true. You know, people talk about soap storylines, and then you read things in the press. It's like, oh, my God.
We have a game like that here on SoapBox.
And that's
true
actually,
fact or fiction.
That's actually a very good segue to introduce our guest. Holland Reid is on the phone with us. Hi, Holland.
Hi, Holland.
Hey, how are you?
Doing great. Holland is our...
Does that sound okay? I'm in a little bit of a room right now. I'm just wondering if I sound okay or should I try to...
You sound great.
Sound fine.
You sound like a master of current events. Our in-house spin doctor from HLN Now. So, Holland, I want to talk about the Kimye wedding.
Kimye wedding is that for King in Italy. I'm sorry, but literally, can you wait? I can't wait, A, to see what she's going to wear.
Right.
B, to see what he's going to wear.
I know.
What is he going to have on, I think.
So they're getting married at Versailles, right?
Is that where they're getting married in Versailles?
I cannot wait to see. I mean, as much as we want to hate on both of them, which I have a love-hate relationship with them, they are a beautiful couple with a beautiful little girl.
True.
I can't wait to see what all they're going to pull out. You know there's literally no holds barred here. I believe they're going to pull out all the stops.
Oh, of course they are. He got her a wall of flowers for her bridal shower, baby shower, whatever shower it was.
Was that for photos? I still don't understand what you do with a wall of flowers.
Because he wanted to get her the most flowers he could get her, and that the way to do that was to build a wall of flowers.
That is so funny.
Or he could have bought a garden if he wanted to do it.
I actually had a boyfriend fill my apartment with fresh roses. I mean, filled. I walked in, and instead of being flattered, I was like, is somebody dying? I thought it was the weirdest thing. I'm like, I'm a simple girl. One beautiful rose will do.
Well, you know what she did with her wall of flowers was she actually tweeted it out that it was... the only thing that she could do with that wall was to take a selfie of her butt in front of it, which she did.
What?
Yep.
No.
That was her response.
No.
You know, that's what I think of when I think of a wall of flowers, is that let me get my butt in
there. Right?
Yeah, especially since that butt has already been deflowered, I'm sure. Speaking of that.
Oh, touche.
Yeah.
I think there's video of that, as a matter of fact.
Oh, I'm loving Vincent. This is the Vincent, the fun one.
So, Holland, did you hear that V. Stiviano is going to be on, or was on Dr. Phil yesterday?
Oh, yes.
Okay.
Yes.
On Dr. Phil, minus the visor, minus the, you know, I guess... there's so many things wrong with this girl. I smelled something rotten when she first came onto the scene. I said, you know what? Anybody that puts themselves in a situation with a man this age and a billionaire, they're out for something. Now, granted, she may have may not have leaked the tape, whatever. But for you to try to convince me and the public, America, whoever's watching Dr. Phil, that you did not at any point have sex with this man for $1.8 million, I don't care if he is a billionaire and that maybe is only $10 to him, you are doing something on the side to get that money. There is an ooh and an ah happening in your life. in order to drive that Bentley, and you are not going to tell me that
that's fine.
Because you weren't a fast typer that you were a good woman to him,
right.
that was enough. I'm sorry. He doesn't even seem like the type. He's a complete creep.
Well, tell us how you really feel,
Holland. Yeah.
So,
I'm sensitive to this subject because you know why? Men like this in these positions of power, they take advantage of women, or women take advantage of the situation.
Yeah, I feel like she was in the driver's seat on this one.
She's milking this one really nicely. I mean, when you're standing there offering the press to drink coconut juice, water, and aloe vera juice, I mean, come on, and she's skating around, dancing.
Well, so this is what Dr. Phil said to her in the clip that I saw was, why the visor?
Exactly.
And she
welding visor.
She said, it's to cover up my pain. And he said, he showed a clip of her on roller skates with the visor hanging out with the paparazzi and said, I don't see pain in this.
Yeah.
And she said, what am I supposed to do? Sit down and cry?
Yeah.
And it's like,
what did you want me doing? Drugs?
Or
drinking?
Right. Or just go away. I mean,
or how about this? How about stay in your house or stay out of the public eye by not recording and releasing tapes to begin with? And if you did have a problem with him being a racist, you take it to the head of the NBA, you take it to official, and you do it in private. But no, she wanted the attention. She wanted the attention.
Sure.
You put on a visor, a colorful visor, and you think people aren't going to take pictures of you? I'm going to need you to grow up and get a sense of 2014 where everybody wants to be famous.
Holland. Wow, wow, wow.
So this is why I love Holland Reid. Holland, you're going to be on HLN later today. What time, right?
You know what? I think it's going to re-air. It just aired. I think it might be re-airing in a couple hours, but as soon as I find out, I'll let you know. It just depends on what breaking news there. Sometimes segments get chopped up, obviously, if they have something coming in that's super important.
Got it.
Not Hollywood gossip. My segment will get cut and be
got it.
Later, you know, time, but... It is going to re-air. It aired a little bit earlier, around 2:15, so it'll probably air probably this evening sometime.
Very good.
Today I was doing the HLN on the case, and then a couple of little other segments just involving our lovely, you know, Hollywood gossip and entertainment, internet, Facebook, you know, Vine, people that want to be famous. All that
I love it. All right. Well, everyone, you can check out Holland Reid on HLN on the case and on HLN now. You can follow her on Twitter at Holland Reid. Thank you, Holland. Have a good one.
Thank you, guys. I hope to talk to you soon.
Yes.
Sorry I'm being so aggressive about this.
You know? Aggression is good.
We like it.
All right, guys. Have a great day.
Bye. In other soap news, big news today, which you may not have heard about yet, Gina Tognoni is taking over for Michelle Stafford as Phyllis on The Young and the Restless.
Well, good for her.
I think that is huge
news.
It's
a great recast. Yeah. I'm really, really happy with that.
Yeah, we've been talking about this for the last couple of weeks. Like, who are they really going to do this? And who could possibly take over that role? And her name repeatedly came up. I'm a huge fan of Gina Tognoni. I'm really excited
to see
Michael Logan from TV Guide broke that story this morning. Mm-hmm. If you ever really want to know what is happening in the world of soaps before anyone else, you should follow Michael Logan on Twitter. He's always got the good scoop. Anyway, so I just thought I'd throw that out there for our listeners who might not know that. Weird news.
Yes.
Weird news. A grown woman was recently jailed in Texas for going back to high school and pretending she was 15 years old.
That's weird.
Yeah, that is weird.
Okay, so 31-year-old Charity Ann Johnson posed as a 15-year-old girl who managed to enroll at an East Texas high school.
That's her?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
The school's principal said, quote, she was a good student, she was respectful, she did her work, got A's and B's. There were no red flags going up at all. The kids all loved her. He went on to say, quote, why would you as an adult put yourself through this and have to do all this schoolwork all over again?
So what is that about?
Yeah,
well,
nobody
really does know. She still doesn't have her story. There's no story. She was kind of a roamer, decided to fake her identity and go back to this Christian high school where she was very well liked and did very well in school and lived with a foster family who also didn't realize that she wasn't 15 years old.
She lived with a foster family.
They enrolled her into this into this school. I guess my thoughts on this are
does she look that young?
That's crazy.
She did. I saw another picture of her. I did see another picture of her. She looked pretty young. But my question is, I get that faking your identity is against the law.
Yeah.
And I get that acting like a 15-year-old when you're 31 might be a little creepy. But if all she wants to do is go get an education, is that terrible?
Well, she's passing herself off as a 15-year-old and living with a family.
And she's doing well.
Yeah. But you can do that without faking your identity.
Well, maybe
that's an option.
But maybe
you realize
maybe
that.
She's trying to relive a youth that she didn't have.
Well, then you go to a counselor to work that out.
Right, and it's at the expense of other people. Yeah. I mean, his family is providing for her.
Exactly.
They're a foster family, right?
Is it terrible that she's 31 years old and maybe this family was still helping her?
Wait, are you saying why should she go to jail for it?
Why should she go to jail and, like, what is she doing that's so wrong?
To have to go to jail?
Right.
I understand that aspect of it.
Well, I think there's some definitely psychological issues. I think that's going to have to be examined. I don't know if it's criminal.
And that's
as
really
much
where she should be is getting that
criminal,
kind of help, not in jail.
I don't know. I was trying to really analyze why I feel sorry for her. Like, I kind of feel like, okay, if you want to come hang out my house, I'll
she wasn't out robbing somebody, hurting somebody, raping anybody. I mean,
she's just trying to go to school.
She's just trying to be somebody that she's not.
The penal system could also be considered as another foster family home then for her.
Right?
That's what's going to happen. You never know.
I don't know. All right, you guys. It's time for you to tweet your questions for Vincent on Twitter at the Radio Soapbox. Or you can call us in 855-878-4652. We'll be right back on TRadioV. Can't you taste this, girl? Remember my name. Got to blow, oh, oh. I felt a chill in a spill of moonlight. She was there, though we both held very still. There was something pulling in the air when she whispered. I tried hard to hold my ground. I believed I had a choice till the music in her voice turned my whole world.
I wasn't holding that camera, by the way. And here I was asking if he can sing. So I have a question.
Sure.
So you were talking about how this exec at Showtime was a fan of your work and got you the audition for Homeland.
Right.
So does it ever surprise you both who ends up being soap fans? Does that happen? Like,
yes.
I have so much to say. Okay, I want to ask two questions. So first of all, you are currently surprised by who ends up knowing your work and being a fan of it, right?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Happens all the time. Mm-hmm. I meet sometimes executives from other companies, from other vocations. I meet lawyers. You know, that's what, when I first started on Guiding Light, when I was Lou Jack, that was the one big surprise, that people would be coming up to me in the streets of New York with their attaché cases, you know, and they'd be like with their suits, and, oh, I love you as Lou Jack. I'm going, I can't believe you watch this show. Oh,
exactly.
We've been watching it for years, and you know, there are people, it's because some of them, they grew up with it, and that's what they watch. And, I get it. I was at an event last night at UCLA at Royce Hall, and there was a few people that were coming up to me that I was surprised by.
Just
they
never
look,
expected.
They don't. It's it's kind of, it's a very broad demographic.
Yeah,
you
right.
know, when it comes down to it, that's the truth.
Now, obviously, having an exec at Showtime get you an audition for Homeland is a perk.
Yeah,
are there any, what have been one of your biggest perks that you've gotten from soap fans?
Oh boy, that's a tough question to pull out. Right now I'm trying to think of what that might be.
Okay, I'll give you one.
Okay, go ahead. Thank you.
Yeah.
I'll save
the moment. So check this out. When I was on General Hospital, guess who was my fan?
Who?
Stevie Nicks.
Oh, wow.
What?
Stevie
that's
Nicks.
Fantastic.
Did you get concert tickets?
Invited me to her private concert where I sat next to Sheryl Crow.
Wow.
And I'm sitting there going, I love being a soap star.
That's so funny.
Jody Watley comes up to me at the mall.
Jody Watley. Jody, that's a name I haven't heard in forever.
I was so excited when I saw her. And then she comes up to me. I wouldn't dare go up to her. She comes up to me. She's like, oh, my God, I love you on General Hospital. I'm like, what the hell is going on? So what are some of your greatest perks?
Actually, a lot of guys in sports, like Lawrence Taylor, the Giants were huge fans of All My Children. And Lawrence Taylor was a big fan.
So funny.
Also, I've heard Billy Idol was a very big fan of Guiding Light when I was on. There's Lou Jack. Yeah. That's what I was told that you told me that.
Julia Roberts, a big fan of
One that was
Days
really interesting, I went
Shut
to
up.
A celebrity, oh really?
Wow. Shut up.
One time I was going, I was at a celebrity golf tournament, and I can't remember where it was, it may have been Wilmington, North Carolina, and it was a big black tie affair, and a lot of celebrities were there, a lot of sports people, and I'm walking by, and somebody grabs my arm, and I look down, and it's Richard Roundtree from Shaft, you know, he plays Shaft, and he goes, you were the baddest motherfucker on daytime. And I'm saying that verbatim. That's exactly what he said. I don't usually speak like that. But that's what he said. I'm like, are you kidding me? Shaft is telling me that I'm the baddest motherfucker.
So cool. That is a life motto.
That was very cool. It was great. He's a sweetheart. He's such a nice guy. It was great. But he was a big fan of
What's
David.
What's yours, Martha?
You know, I was once at a... not really a club, kind of a bar loungy thing here in Hollywood. And this very well-known casting director who, you know, she's one of the casting directors that you want to get in for all the time, came up to me and she's like, oh my God, you're Belle and Days. I'm a big fan. I didn't know who she was. And she's like, I have to get you in my office sometime. And I was like, your office? What do you do? And she's like, my name is so-and-so and I'm this really big. And I was like, you don't have to tell me who you are. I've been trying to get in your office for like 3 years. And she's like, come on in. And that was kind of when you go, wow.
Well, that's actually a good thing.
Casting director out there who doesn't think that soaps are less than, you know.
Yeah,
well,
exactly.
There are a lot of casting directors that look at the actors from daytime.
They
in
do.
A respectable way.
But they I've
do.
Also had a manager tell me that there are a lot of people out there that won't see you
exactly.
because
right.
you've been
that
on a soap. And so it's about kind of like for me, she was giving me the conversation of moderating my resume. Like, why don't we put just this one on? You know, they don't need to know that you've been on three soaps.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
And where I think that's like a feather in my cap, a lot of people don't.
Which is so unfair.
Yeah.
It is so unfair.
Yeah.
So, Twitter questions would like to know if Vincent Irizarry plans a new Fall in Love show. Love to hear him sing. I don't know what that means.
Okay. what you saw me singing there on the monitor, that was from a show that I produced called Fall in Love Again with your favorite soap star. It was Bobby Eakes was involved with it. Walt Willey was involved with
it. I love Walt.
Yeah. So Jacob Yug was supposed to do that one, but he was doing B&B, and it was the weekend of Hurricane Sandy, so he couldn't fly in. So I produced it. We did it several times. We did it at
B.B.
Turning
King's,
Stone
right?
Resort Casino. Oh. Yeah, we did it there and also at B.B. King's. So that's what they're asking if I'm going to do another one.
And?
Maybe. We'll see. You know, everybody seems to be doing their own things. It's always hard to pull everybody together. And producing it, it had certain headaches that were sort of obviously inherent in being the sole producer of something. Mm-hmm. And to have the shows both times, when we did a Turning Stone Resort and Casino, the show that we did there was an ice storm, okay? It was like the weekend after Valentine's Day. It was an ice storm throughout the whole day. Then we did it at B.B. King's, and it was Hurricane Sandy.
Oh, my gosh.
We were
and
the
then
only
we had a
show.
Nor'easter right after that, too.
Right. We were stuck in New York, and it was the only show that was done in the Broadway area. Everything else closed down that night.
I was there.
And
it
they
was totally dark.
They wouldn't close it because they said we were well past the break-even point, so they said, we're on. I'm like, everybody's closed down.
Did
There's
everybody
no public
come?
Transportation. We had sold like 400 and some odd seats, and about 50 people showed up.
Those are really dedicated.
And some of them, my friend Rachel, she drove from Virginia. I was like, you know, some people did drive. But there were people in Manhattan that couldn't come because there was no public transportation. They
That's
were like
right.
2-3 miles away. And like,
That's
I don't
right.
want to get caught in the hurricane
yeah.
without subway, without a bus, or
That's
any
right.
way to get around. So
That's right.
it was so frustrating. So that one kind of took the desire out of it for me.
You think?
And then I got stuck in New York for several days. Like my flights kept canceling.
But you do have an event coming up. It's a Soap Fantasy Weekend, October 25th and 26th. Mm-hmm. You've got Kelly Sullivan, Alicia Minshew, who I love, Vanessa Marcel, Scott Reeves, Darnell Williams, Tamar Bond, and more. You can get your tickets at Eventbrite by typing in Soap Fantasy Reunion Weekend. That sounds like a really good time. Are you going to be singing at that?
We're talking about that. I think there's one of the events that we're going to be doing that weekend that there's going to be singing and that's live performance. And so I'm talking with them about the possibility of doing at least one or maybe two songs. So we'll sing.
One more question from Outtakes Interviews. What was Vincent's favorite storyline as Dr. Hayward?
Oh, that's tough. I had so many great storylines on that show. There are some that are memorable that the audience loved. It's the whole Libida Zone storyline was fun. I don't know, you probably don't know it, but it was that David was also into pharmaceutical research. He had a company, and he created a drug called Libida Zone that like stripped away any of your inhibitions. And,
oh, wow. And that, I want some of that.
And accidentally, he meant to give it to Tad at a party, but someone hit his arm and the flask went into a punch bowl and everybody got it.
No,
and then
how
it was like
fun.
A wild weekend where everybody went crazy. They were all over each other.
Shut up.
And
that was fun.
And that was fun. That was
any,
fun.
Any method actors during that?
Yeah, is that right? If they were, they certainly weren't telling us. We didn't videotape it.
Well, Vincent, thank you so much for coming and spending the whole hour with us. We had a great time. Went by way too fast.
Thank you.
Don't forget to check out, you can check out Vincent's website at vincent-irizarry.com. You can also check us out on Twitter at the Radio Soapbox. If you know someone who loves soaps, tell a friend, tell them to come and follow us too. You can follow Vincent at Vincent Irizarry. We are taping a special Soapbox with Lily and Martha at the Days of Our Lives Fan Weekend, June the 8th. You can get your tickets at yournumberonefan.com. We have Jade Harlow, Brian DeTillo, Jen Lilly, Eric Martzoff, Chriselle Stouse, and surprise, surprise, we have Galen Gehring, too. So get your tickets at yournumberonefan.com next week. Mary Beth Evans is on the
finally.
Show. She is going to wrap up our Bay May here on the Soapbox. So don't miss out next Thursday, 2 p.m. Pacific on TRadioV. It's radio and TV. Peace.